Okay, please have a seat. Distinguished guests, and in particular, I'd like to welcome our guests from China. Ladies and gentlemen, warmly welcome to this seminar at EVA. My name is Björn O. Nilsson, and I have the big pleasure of being the president of this academy, the Royal Swedish Academy of Engineering Sciences. We were the first seminars per year. We also run in parallel between 10 and 15 projects, and we were founded during the First World War as an idea, and then it became founded in 1919 because of an energy crisis during that war. Our first report was on energy 1920, and since then the Academy has constantly been working on energy matters, in particular to come up with an idea for policy making in Sweden. I predict in 100 years this academy will still work on energy, but not the same energy issues. They vary. The first one, the reason for why EVA was founded, was called the turf crisis, torvkrisen. I predict that may not be a subject for the future, even though turf could indeed be an interesting contributor. Today we will hear about new very interesting journey. So with those words, I'd like to present our moderator, Mr. Energy, or Mr. HVDC in Sweden, I think both, Bo Nordmark. Please give him a hand.
Thank you, Björn. It's an honor for me, of course, to be leading this seminar, because some of you might know that I have a background in this topic we are going to talk about, which is mega-scale transmission as a key enabler. So let me take you 17 years back in time. At that time, Sweden was facing a challenge to actually transport renewable energy from Harsprånget in northern Sweden down to central and south of Sweden. And that resulted in the construction of the first 400 kilovolt AC transmission line. That is still the bulk of the energy in Europe is still transmitted with this same type of technology. Then I will jump 40 years in time, and then I will go to our neighboring country, Denmark. Because at that time, right about in the middle of the 1990s, Denmark started to take the first lead in developing wind energy to become something more than a toy. It became commercial. And Denmark was clever enough to realize that to build wind power in large quantities is good for neighbors. So that was a base and a strategy actually to have interconnections with neighboring countries. Still at that time, some people had the belief that wind power as being a distributed energy should require less transmission. I think those of you that studied this war saw that that was not the case. We would need more transmission because wind power by nature has an economy of scale. Bigger is cheaper, and that is still the case. Around the same time, in the mid-1990s, China was facing challenges with building up the energy system. Electricity has always played a major role in China's development. China was very, very early, despite the economic level overall in country, it was an electrified country, very early. And China was started looking at building more and bigger transmission lines. So I was actually in China many times at that time. And around 2000, China announced that they were going to build a national grid where HVDC technology was going to play a major role. At that time, we were quite proud as engineers if we could build 500, maybe 600 kilovolt DC, but that was not enough. And It coincides with the fact that I think that 2004, our guest of honor today, Mr. Liu, became chairman of State Grid. Just 1 year later, it was decided that China will build 800 kilovolt DC. And they challenged the industry because that technology didn't exist. And they challenged the industry, and they were able to do this with a capacity of 6,000 megawatt. Later also, I think still when Mr. Liu was in office, the first 1,100 kilovolt DC contract was signed in 2016. And this technology will make it possible to transmit 12,000 megawatt in one transmission line. We're over a distance of 3,300 kilometers, which happened to be the distance from Harsprånget to Rome, if you would like to build a line there. There are some hurdles in the way, but in theory, that's how far you can go. So today for me is an honor, of course, to host this seminar where we are going to discuss is it still a role to play, or maybe an increasing role to play for mega-scale transmission system. And we also link this as a key enabler to develop more renewable energy. And I think we will have this actually highlighted from both the big picture and also a more local picture in Europe. You will find translation, some practical details, English on channel 1, Mandarin on channel 2. And this is the full seminar that we are going to conduct. And I start with introducing here Thomas Kåberger. He is known to many of you, and we have to select among his titles. Today we selected Professor, Department of Space, Earth and Environment at Chalmers University of Technology. Thomas is also an EVA member and many other things. But now Thomas will talk about the current state of renewable energy. Please, Thomas.
Thank you. Thank you, Wu. It's a pleasure to be at EVA and celebrate industrial progress in the electricity industry and talk about what potentials lie in the future based on these successful developments that we have seen over the last few years. Maybe the most important process driving industrial development is the desire to decrease cost and the ability of engineers to decrease cost by gaining more experience. This diagram is from a book that my former colleague Klaus Otto Wehner published in Paris at OECD in the year 2000, showing that wind and solar in particular were industries that were far from mature and where cost could decrease faster than for conventional sources of electricity. And his suggestion, inherent in the title of the book, in experience curves for technology, energy technology policy, was suggesting if you just subsidize these technologies for a few years, they will become so cheap that they outcompete conventional sources of electricity without further subsidies. What we have seen in the world is some countries supporting the development of these technologies before they became competitive. This growth curve of global wind power is, at least in the first 10 years of this century, outpacing any published prediction, scenario, vision, or report from the 20th century. Greenpeace published a report at the very end of the 20th century, 1998, and even they, who were at the time at least the energy campaigner, embarrassed that it was unrealistically optimistic about wind power, failed to predict that the growth would be as fast as it actually was. The reason is represented here today is China. No one in Europe in the 20th century believed that China would go from having virtually no wind power up until 2005 to being number one in the world by 2010. But again, I know from my periods in China that the Chinese were also very fond of learning curves. If the Chinese economic development would be attempted relying solely on non-renewable uranium, oil, coal and gas, the understanding was the more we succeed with economic growth, the higher the prices of these finite resources will be. But when looking at learning curves and seeing that the more we deploy of renewable energy technologies, the cheaper they will get, was to those Chinese experts I then met, a very much more attractive alternative. So this development of wind power is based on roughly building a little more than 2 wind power plants per hour, day and night, all around the year for the last 10 years. Solar capacity has grown very fast too, globally. Almost a quarter, at least, between a fifth and a quarter of all the solar PV installed in the world has been installed in the last 12 months. And as some of you know, China here too is the main driver during the last couple of years, whilst most of the paying financing of the industrial development has been done by German households. So it's just a little exaggeration saying that German households have saved the world, but considering the fact that the solar PV panels have now become cheap and are now used extensively in countries like China where they substitute air-polluting fossil fuels, it is definitely a major achievement, as I said, paid for by German households. But now the industrial development in this industry too is led by China. And if you look at the installations last year of roughly as much solar capacity in the year 2016 that they had on New Year's Eve, and the equivalent of all the accumulated installed capacity in the other major nations, such as the US and Japan and Germany. It is a remarkable industrial achievement in China, and reports from the first 7 months of this year suggest China installed another 34 gigawatt in the first 7 months. While the previous graphs showed installed capacity, which tend to make solar and wind look larger than thermal power plants because thermal power plants operate for more hours during the year in reasonable conditions, it's also worth noting that in the last few years, since 2013, renewables have also added more new delivered electricity, not just capacity, than solar. And most importantly, learning curves have continued to work. And 2016 was a year when costs for renewables visibly came down below the cost of thermal power, of old types of electricity generation. One of the first clear reports to this end was from Morocco that made a procurement of electricity from onshore wind power, and they got winning bids between $25 and $30 per megawatt hour. In solar, the year started, 2016 that was, with what was described as tremendously low, 4.8 cents per kilowatt hour in Peru. Many thought this would never happen again, at least not for decades, but just a few weeks later, a similar contract was won in Mexico at about 5 cents per kilowatt hour or $50 per megawatt hour. When then that was thought to be the lowest possible, in May already last year, Dubai got a contract below $30 per megawatt hour. And a similar contract then in Chile. And after that, a contract in Abu Dhabi at 2.4 cents per kilowatt hour. Now, all these are bids, not all are built, and some of them have slightly different conditions. And I know this one, 2.4 cents per kilowatt hour, has some rather special conditions that makes it a little lower than if you really included all relevant costs. But again, we've had contracts also in Mexico, well below $30 per megawatt hour. These contracts are offered in countries with a lot of solar irradiation. And there are, as we will hear later, major differences in how much solar energy is available per square meter in different parts of the world. A good reason for cooperating and exchanging electricity from different sources. And we can see that it fits quite well. The cost of building the solar power plant is the same in Mexico or Abu Dhabi as they are in, for example, Denmark. And when Denmark and Germany held an auction last year, in the end of last year, a Danish project won at about 5.5 euro cent per kilowatt hour. That is roughly twice the price or the cost of these more solar-rich countries that do have approximately twice as much solar irradiation per year. So it seems there are no engineering difference, it's a resource difference. Vattenfall has been active in offshore wind power, and this is a source of power where Northern Europe and the polar areas have great advantages. The costs have also dropped dramatically during last year. In July last year, Dong won a procurement outside the Dutch coast, and the price was then a little more than 70 euros per megawatt hour. August last year was a boring month, but in September, Vattenfall won a contract outside the Danish west coast at 60 euros per megawatt hour, which was, again, record cheap. October, again, a boring month, but November saw Vattenfall winning the contract for Kriegers Flak between Denmark and Germany, and the price now, or the bid, below 50 euros per megawatt hour. And Vattenfall was very proud of winning that at that low price in November. And what else happened in November last year? Well, World Energy Outlook from the IEA in Paris was published. And they had, as usual, outlooks, scenarios for the future. And in one of their most ambitious scenarios, with a management of 450 ppm CO2, in the atmosphere and successful deployment of renewables, they did have a price projection for the different sources of power in different parts of the world. And in their projection of European Union, they had for offshore wind by 2040, the projection you could reach $100 per megawatt hour. And that was published the same month as the bid from Vattenfall was less than 50 euros per megawatt hour. Approximately half the price that the IEA predicted for 2040. So development has been dramatic in decreasing costs in the last couple of years, and it has been faster than anticipated by international organizations like the IEA. The offshore wind contracts do not include infrastructure in these cases, and infrastructure may add another 10, 15, euros per megawatt hour, approximately. But we will hear later about how you can do this in a rational way, in a large scale, in the North Sea. This year, another bidding process outside the German coast was, in three cases, won by Dong and NBV, saying they would offer electricity from their offshore installations without any subsidies. What price they assume the electricity market in Germany would provide in the 2020s, 2030s is a little difficult to guess, but it would not be very high considering the other competitive alternatives. You may also say, well, maybe they will not build these plants, though they have given this offer. But it does cost the company quite a lot if you win a bidding competition and do not build. So it is definitely a noteworthy contract regarding how cheap solar and wind, or offshore wind in this case, can actually get. Cheap renewable electricity opens up the opportunity not only to substitute fossil fuels for electricity generation, but also to substitute fossil fuels in other sectors. And this very simple diagram is just showing the relationship between the electricity price in dollars per kilowatt hour and the equivalent energy price of crude oil. And the point is that you might like to draw out of this diagram is that if electricity costs 3 cents per kilowatt hour, it is actually cheaper than oil at, at 30 here, it's about $45 per barrel, lower than today's oil price. So unlike what we all learned some years ago, at least by one very vocal Swedish professor, that electricity always costs three times as much as fuel, is no longer true. Electricity is no longer produced by fuels. Instead, fuels can be produced from electricity. And fuels can be substituted by electricity. We see it in the road transport sector, where Tesla is gaining enormous progress in the Norwegian market, where Tesla is now the car that has sold most copies in 1 month, when it took the record from the former record holder Ford Sierra in 1983. Greatly subsidized still in Norway, but the development is not only a car issue. We now see buses developing in Sweden as well as in Australia. And in Australia, they managed to build a bus that could run 1,000 kilometers on one charge. Heavy bus, even speed on a highway, but still, 1,000 kilometers on one charge. Norway saw the first battery electric ferry, first a small one like this, and then Sweden and Denmark managed to develop a distinctly larger ferry between Helsingborg and Helsingør on batteries. And even aviation is now going into all electric flights. Airbus started to produce a two-seated trainer aircraft in 2015. And this year we saw the announcement of a four-seater aircraft with battery electric drivetrain only. And then the role of power lines. As Bo mentioned, Sweden was a country where we saw the benefit of learning to transmit electricity over long distances. And it is an obvious case for an engineer that if you want to transfer electricity over a long distance, you should use as high voltage as possible to minimize losses. And this was what Vattenfall and ASEA at the time managed to do, raising the voltage level, reducing losses, and making the economic utilization of the huge hydropower resources in northern Sweden by consumers in southern Sweden possible. As a result, ASEA had a leading position in this industry for a long time, thanks to this cooperation between Vattenfall and ASEA. Then China faced similar challenges. Consumption demand was in the east, while resources were in the west. And Bo described the interaction he has had with China, and Mr. Liu, as president of State Grid Corporation, was again a demanding, ambitious, knowledgeable engineer who managed to set high targets that were high enough to result in progress, but not so high they were unrealistic. And as a result, Chinese companies, with some involvement of ABB, managed to resolve these challenges and reach the new levels of transmission capacity that Bo mentioned. While Sweden had a voltage of about half a megavolt, China is now in the order of 1 megavolt, when Sweden had capacities for power lines of about 1 gigawatt, China now has 10 gigawatt. And because of this, international long-distance transmission of electricity has become possible. The renewables have provided another incentive to utilize the resource-rich areas rather than the resource-poor, giving a good reason for transmission from the resource-rich to the demand-rich areas. And we also have variations in consumption as a driving force and variation in production, especially from solar and wind plants that do not always produce. So we have a need and we have significant opportunities in developing transmission and international grids as a solution. And I would say, if we look again at the Swedish map, there is one thing that we have developed in Sweden that few other countries have developed and gained a lot of experience of. And that is how to organize an electricity market so that you can have efficient international trade in electricity. Our infrastructure investments that now comprise in the order of 16, 17 international connections from Sweden to its neighboring countries is made efficient because we have an electricity market which is integrated in a clever way so that the potential of international cooperation is really utilized for maximum economic benefit. So with this, I think it is a day where we can celebrate the progress made over the last few years in this industry, where new technologies have made the solution of the long-term energy problems that Björn described as one of the key issues of this academy. These problems are now easier to solve than ever. And it is time to look at how should these technologies be utilized for the benefit of humankind. Thank you.
Thank you, Thomas. I think it's for now, I think it's quite obvious that we have a tremendous development in renewable energy in terms of cost and the implementation possibilities. But it's also time to go back to the old idea that if you want to maximize the use of renewables, it's good to have neighbors. And then you can talk about neighbors that is are inside the country, outside the country. So in that context, it's very interesting now to widen the perspective to see what increased role could actually large-scale transmission take in promoting introduction of renewable energy. And our keynote speaker is Mr. Shenjia Liu, and he has been a chairman for, as I mentioned, from 2004 to 2016 in State Grid in China, which is a very big company. I mean, for us in Sweden, we don't understand, but we talk about 2 million employees. That's a big portion of Sweden. But Mr. Liu managed to take this organization in a good direction by being a visionary, to talk about the vision for China and how you, by introducing higher and higher voltages, more and more capacity in both AC and DC lines, could actually build a very efficient grid in China. And I would say that today China has the most modern grid in the world. After retiring recently from State Grid, Mr. Liu has continued now to work at the Global Energy Interconnection, which is an idea to take this example one step further. It will be very interesting to listen to his presentation and his visions about how large-scale power transmission could serve an even bigger purpose, and that is to extend the renewable energy integration beyond borders and maybe even beyond continents. So I'm very proud to introduce Mr. Yu as next speaker, and we have the English on channel one. Yes, Mr. Liu.
中国特格亚电网发展的时间，特格亚是世界级技术难题，上世纪60年代起，前苏联、日本等国做过特格亚的试验研究，设备研制和工程尝试，但工程没有成功。2004年以来，中国国家电网公司全力推进特格亚技术创新和工程应用，实现了技术装备、标准和工程的全面突破。技术方面，建成了特格亚交流支流杆塔高海拔40个试验基地和国家电网放地中心。我们这个高海拔试验基地啊，是在西藏的羊巴井，海拔在4300米以上。过去我们世界没有这么高的高度，有些绝缘曲线是描绘出来的啊。 形成了世界上试验能力最强、技术水平最高的特格亚试验研究体系，攻克了过电压与绝缘配合、电磁环境控制、特格亚大电网安全控制等世界的技术难题。设备方面，成功研制了世界上电压等级最高、容量最大的单体变压器、直流换流阀换流变压器。 开端能力最强的开关设备等21大类近北向首台首套特格亚的关键设备。标准方面，建立较为完整的特格亚技术标准体系，发布国家标准14项，国际标准14项，国家标准50项，行业标准73项。 中国特格亚交流电压成为国际标准电压，国际电工委员会的5个专委会秘书处设在中国国家电网公司。工程方面 ，2009年1月 建成世界首个商业运行的特格亚交流工程 ，2010年7月20号 建成世界首个特格亚直流工程。截止到目前， 中国已经建成并投运8角9支10起个特格亚交流工程，正在建设的是2角4支6个特格亚工程，已经投运和正在建设的特格亚线路的长度达到3.5万公里，已投运变电换流容量超过3.6亿千伏安，成为西电东送、北电南供的 能源大通道，特格亚电网的成功建设有力促进了中国能源的发展，一是保证了电力供应。中国电力装机已经达到了16亿千瓦，年人均用电量达到4200千瓦时，解决了近14亿人口的用电问题；二是优化了能源结构，非化石能源装机的比重达到了36%。 其中，水电、风电、太阳能发电装机分别达到了 3.4亿千瓦、1.6亿千瓦、1.1亿千瓦，均居世界第一位。三是促进了能源大范围的优化配置，跨区输电能力超过1亿千瓦，每年可以送电超过5000亿千瓦时，有效缓解了 东中部供电和环境的压力。总之，特格亚电网在中国已经取得了巨大的成功，实践验证了特格亚输电的先进性、安全性、经济性和环境友好性。中国正在建设以特格亚交流和直流 为骨干网架、高级电网协调发展的中国能源互联网，并将陶格亚技术输出到巴西等国。我们在巴西啊，正在建设两个陶格亚政府巴比千分之一滞留工程。第一个工程将于明年正式投运，第二个工程将于2019年正式投运。 第一个工程是我们和巴西电力公司共同出资建设，我们50%的股份，巴西电力49%。第二个工程我们是100%的股份，而且我们是EPC总包并运营。成为技术创新的中国名片，引领世界进入了陶格亚电网的新的时代。第二大部分。 全球能源互联网与能源变革，全球能源互联网是基于陶格亚电网成功实践后而提出的，是引领世界能源可持续发展的战略创新，核心是发挥陶格亚手段技术的优势，促进清洁能源在全球范围内优化配置，推动世界能源从化石能源为主导。 向清洁能源为主导的转型，让人人享有可持续能源。什么是全球能源互联网？全球能源互联网是清洁能源在全球范围大规模开发、输送、使用的重要平台，是清洁主导、电为中心、全球互联共建共享的能源综合体系，也是以 清洁发电为主的电力系统，实质上就是智能电网加陶格亚电网加清洁能源。智能电网是基础，能够适应各类集中式、分布式的清洁能源的灵活接入，实现源网合出、协同优化、多能互补和高效的使用，满足用户多样的需求。陶格亚电网是关键，能够实现 数千公里、千万千瓦级的电力输送和跨区、跨国、跨州电网互联，全球各大清洁能源基地和复合地区都在陶格亚电位的覆盖范围内。清洁能源是根本，北极的风电和赤道的太阳能发电及一级一道以及各国的集中式和分布式 清洁发电将成为主导能源，是实现绿色低碳发展的根本保证。为什么要建设全球能源互联网？建设全球能源互联网是应对世界能源挑战的现实需要。全球化石能源占一次能源消费的比重超过了 80%， 按目前的开发强度，全球已探明的 煤炭和油气等储量只能在开采100亿时多年和50多年。大规模开发使用化石能源，还将带来环境污染和气候变暖等突出问题。工业革命以来，全球的地表平均温度上升超过1度，如不控制，本世纪末全球的温升将超过4度，严重威胁人类的生存。 全球还有10.6亿人没有用上电和用不起电，27亿人只能依靠木材、煤炭、动物的粪便做饭取暖。依托全球能源互联网，以清洁和绿色的方式满足全球电力需求，人类将摆脱化石能源的依赖，根本解决资源紧缺、环境污染、气候变化 和无电人口以及用不起电的问题。建设全球能源互联网是加快能源变革的必由之路，将有力推动两个替代、一个提高、一个回归，从根本上破解能源资源和环境的约束，实现地球能源的转型升级。两个替代即能源开发实施、清洁替代。 以 太阳能、风能、水能等清洁能源替代化石能源，能源消费实时电能替代，以电代煤，以电代油，以电代气，电从远方来，来的是清洁发电。一个提高，即提高全社会的电气化水平，降低能源强度，电能产生的经济价值相当于等当量煤炭的 17.3 倍，石油的 3.2 倍。电能占终端能源的比重每提高一个百分点，能源强度将下降 3.7%。 一个回归，即化石能源回归其基本属性，主要作为工业原材料使用，为经济社会发展创造更大的价值。单位原油作为原料创造的经济价值，它可以是作为燃料使用的价值的 1.6 倍。构建全球能源互联网，符合世界能源清洁化、电气化、网络化的发展规律。清洁化是指全球能源体系发展呈现脱碳的趋势，清洁能源将成为主导能源。19世纪末，煤炭取代新柴，20世纪60年代，油气取代煤炭。随着全球清洁能源的迅猛发展，能源体系加快向清洁低碳转型。电气化是指电能在能源体系中的地位越来越突出，电能在终端能源消费中的比重已经从1971年的8.8%提高到2014年的18.1%。当然咱们瑞典这个比较高，超过了30%了啊，先后超过了煤炭、热力和天然气，并将继续提高。网络化是指全球能源体系从局部平衡向全球互联，全球的煤炭、石油、天然气、电力等系统都经历了由单点供应向区域配置、跨国配置和全球配置的网络化的进程。全球能源互联网是以清洁化、电气化、网络化为特征，以电为中心的现代能源体系，能够利用资源差、时区差、季节差、电价差，获得巨大的联网效益，保障能源安全、清洁、低碳、高效益供应。比如讲中国和咱们欧洲啊，时差是7个小时左右，和美国是12到13个小时左右，其中一边是高峰负荷的时候，另一方可能是低谷。大家这电的速度啊是每秒30万公里，虽然在全球范围内来配置这个资源啊是非常经济划算的，这比建什么储能装置它的容量都大，它的效益都更加显著。对这个问题我们也进行了很深入的研究，进行了量化的分析计算，将来会要正式发表啊，发表这些东西啊。构建全球能源互联网的可行性，构建全球能源互联网的条件已经具备。一是资源有保障，全球的水能、陆上风能、太阳能理论开发潜力超过了100亿、1万亿、1000万亿千瓦，仅开发1/5就可以满足全球的能源需求。比如我们进行了一些研究，比如对北极的风能资源进行了研究，像北极的风电年设备利用小时可以超过4000小时。对赤道的太阳能的研究，比如将在撒哈拉沙漠，它的年设备利用小时可以达到3500小时，一般要在2500小时左右。比如将非洲的北非，它太阳能装机可以超过几百万亿千瓦，年发电量可以达到200万亿到300万亿千瓦时。同样，中东、西亚地区 像沙特等国家，他们也是可以年装机超过几百万亿千瓦，发电量二百万亿到三百万亿千瓦时。大家知道现在全球啊，每年也就是几十万亿千瓦时。比如中国2016年年用电量才是5万亿千瓦时，全球才几十万亿。啊，大家可以看出来，世界清洁能源资源之丰富。 只要将最好的资源开发，它可以就满足人类需求。而且将来全球清洁能源的竞争是在全球范围内的，啊，这要看它的资源量、资源的优劣，啊，资源的优劣。不是说谁有钱将来都可以开发清洁能源，事实是要早占这个资源，早占通道。 将来全球就形成一个大的市场，一个家庭、一个企业可以随时网上签订合同购电。你可能购的电说要南美的，其实附近采来的电，但是你的电价就是南美最便宜的电。发电商就要想千方百计来卖最高电价的电。将来全球是一个最大的能源市场，将来这个能源市场将取代油气、煤、柴。 全部基本变为电力这个市场。我们现在也正在研究全球这个电力将来怎么进行交易，交易的规则应该是什么，怎么建立全球的电力交易中心、控制中心等等。我们正在考虑，初步啊已经有规划了，今天我给大家汇报这些的材料，其实我们都做过很深入的研究。 没有做过深入研究，在这个地方也不敢多讲，也不能多讲啊。所以大家看，将来资源是非常丰富的啊，不是资源是问题，关键市场是问题。用什么手段和在当载体，把你开发的资源能够输送到人们需要的地方去，这是成功最重要的地方。
啊，最重要的地方，啊，所以大家说，将来建开发清洁能源、构建全球能源互联网，说钱是问题，钱绝不是问题，绝不是问题，因为它的效益和利润是太高了，太高了啊。二是技术可行，特高压输电技术先进成熟，清洁能源的发电技术不断进步，智能电网技术广泛应用。 三是经济信号，风电、光伏发电的成本过去5年分别下降了 30% 75% 并将持续快速的下降。阿联酋2019年投产，智利2021年投产的光伏项目国际总标价格已经分别降到了每千瓦时 2.4 美分、2.9 美分，摩洛哥。 2020年投产的陆上风电项目，每千瓦时的总标价格已经降至3美分以下。啊，我想这个刚才这个讲的已经很清楚了啊，已经大量的资料说明了这点。我们有这样的比较保守的预测和分析，就是到2025年的时候，整个清洁能源它的竞争力和经济性。 将全面超过化石能源，而且我也直爽地讲，将来核电竞争力也会是很大的问题，啊，它和清洁能源相比也没有竞争力，啊，因为核电安全不是最主要问题，为了安全不断增加造价，关键电价太高，将来啊，所以这是一个趋势，啊。 但是这个问题容易有不同意见，但我还是把它说一说啊。四是市场需求大，预计2016年到2050年，全球电力需求将从24万亿千瓦时增至73万亿千瓦时，年均增长3.1%，20%以上需要跨国 技术问题、经济问题和政治问题，最后必然相协调。技术问题、技术进步带来的经济性的提高，经济性的提高带来了利益归属问题，必然要协调政治，最后大家一致。啊，50国际广泛认同，全球已被42多个国家出台了鼓励发展清洁能源的政策。制定了发展的目标，应对气候变化，推动能源转型，实现可持续发展，已经成为各国的共识和共同的行动。 第四个方面，全球能源互联网发展的格局。建设全球能源互联网总体可以分为国内互联、周内互联、洲际互联三个阶段。从现在到2020年，加快推进各国清洁能源的开发和国内电网的互联、智能电网建设；到2030年，推动周内大型能源基地开发。 和电网的跨国互联，到2050年实现电网跨州互联，基本建成全球能源互联网。基于全球清洁能源的资源禀赋和各个州的经济社会发展的需要，我们研究提出了各州电网互联总体思路，当然只能是比较简略的啊粗放的啊，因为时间关系啊。欧洲目前已经实现。 州内主要国家电网互联，风电、太阳能发电装机分别达到 1.6亿和1.1亿千瓦，这个数正好和中国当前的数是一致的。具有良好的发展基础，要实现欧盟提出的清洁能源发展、碳减排的目标，加快欧洲能源互联网的建设，十分必要。根据欧盟2050能源路线图。 到2050年，欧洲的总用电量需求将比用能总需求将比2005年下降40%，但是电力的需求将达到4.9到5.8万亿千瓦时，较2010年增长58%，也就是整个用能需求是下降的，但是用电的需求。 确实在上升的，上升的。考虑到现有的火电和电的退出，需要增加3.8到4.7万亿千瓦时的年千瓦时的清洁电力，这仅仅依靠欧洲自身的资源实现清洁发展的目标，将面临着很大的困难。为什么这么说呢？你建立啊，清洁能源特别广幅。 要占用大量的有效国土面积。同样有一个资源，品质问题，比如在德国，光伏年设备利用小时是8倍到1000小时；如果在撒哈拉沙漠是3500小时，大家看，如果算成造价，就是3.5倍的关系。所以说，可能北非、西亚中东的电力输送到欧洲。 比在欧洲发的电价格还要便宜得多，竞争性更强。大家不信可以算一算，如果在中东北非，一度电按目前水平3美分，假如考虑2美分的利润5美分，输送2美分到3美分，也包括输送利润，到欧洲落地电价7到8美分，这目前的水平就可以做得到。 实际，我们欧洲很多地方发电厂上网电价超过了这个水平，啊，已经现在就有它的竞争力和空间。所以，将来这个电力是不一定在本州来进行，可能越在本州来做越不划算，越不划算。 大家看，现在有这么多的实物贸易、实体实物贸易，这么多海运空运，将来电力也是全球的最主要贸易形式之一。实现清洁发展的目标，将面临着很大的困难，必须坚持轴内开发，与轴外输电并重，扩大跨国跨州的电力贸易，保障 高比例的清洁能源供应。欧洲能源互联网的建设总体是加强电网的骨干网架建设，支撑轴内清洁能源大规模的开发利用，加快引入非洲和北极的清洁能源，扩大能源供给，推进欧洲、亚洲、非洲电网互联，更大范围的优化配置清洁能源。 我们认为最容易做到的，首先要把亚洲、欧洲和非洲这个电网互联。如果这个电网互联大家可以看，西亚、中东地区将来这是一个很重要的地方。我们规划它可以建成世界的一个电力基地和全球的电力调剂中心，可以把中东建成这个地方，啊，建成欧亚非电网。 美洲是需要什么呢？南美洲互联、北美洲互联，通过中美中美洲把南美北美互联，然后经过北令海峡，再和亚欧非电网再连啊，再连啊。瑞典连接北极与欧洲大陆，清洁能源的资源十分丰富，加快开发国内水电。瑞典国内水电只开发了一半左右。 沿海地区风电，承接北极的清洁电力，实现北电南送，将成为欧洲重要的能源供应基地，在构建欧洲能源互联网和全球能源互联网中，将发挥重要的作用，并为瑞典经济发展带来新的战略性的机遇。非洲加快建设北部、 西部、中部、南部、东部五大区域电网互联网和大型能源基地送出通道，发挥水电的调节器作用，支撑南部、北部风电、太阳能开发，保障轴内电力供应，同时建设非洲到欧洲的输电通道，向欧洲输送富余电力，将资源优势转化为经济优势，带动非洲经济社会的发展。 大家知道，非洲啊，水电资源很丰富。仅港国和它可开发容量超过1亿千瓦，啊，仅大赢家过去说开发4000多万千瓦，技术技术方案调整一下，可能达到5000万甚至6000万千瓦。它的开发出来的成本，啊，尽管投资者都把价格算得很高，啊，我是干电的，我认为不会超过3美分，2美分多的成本。 如果把这个电输送到欧洲来，会有很强的竞争力，会有很强的竞争力。而现在用特高压直流正负1000亿米千伏，6000公里到8000公里，完全在它的射程之内，啊，咱用军事语言讲，在它的射程之内，啊，经济的，完全经济的。而你算一下它的盈利能力多强呢？假如输送到非洲，8美分。 啊，如果一度电1000瓦时，盈利3美分，啊，3美分。如果是900亿度电，一年是多少呢？27亿美元，盈利能力近30亿美元。它的投资会多大呢？也就是1倍多亿美元，所以这回收期会非常快。我简单算一下账啊。亚洲推动形成由中国、东北亚、 东南亚、中亚、南亚、西亚6大电网组成的一家无电网格局，加快开发中国的北部、蒙古、俄罗斯清洁能源，向中国的东部、韩国、日本送电，加快推进南亚、东南亚电力互通，接受中国、中亚、西亚等地区的清洁能源，满足南亚及东南亚国家的电力需求。刚才我讲到是把 蒙古的清洁能源开发输送到中国的东部和韩国和日本。韩国的销售电价一般在15美分一度，日本的销售电价大概在25美分一度电。如果在蒙古开发的清洁能源加入设施3美分左右，输送到中国价格的5美分左右，大家看，进而输送到韩国和日本有多么强的竞争力。 大家看，原来困扰韩国和日本的大量的进口石油、天然气带来的不划算、经济不划算，还有一些能源安全问题，其实这个做法都可以得到解决。为什么？油和气都可以用电来代替，而且油和气现在的技术完全可以转化为电，可以转化油和气啊，变成另外一个物质啊。 美洲加快开发加拿大的水电，美国西南部、中部和墨西哥北部的清洁能源，向美国东西海岸复合地区送电，加快开发亚马逊的水电、智利和秘鲁等国的清洁能源，形成南美洲、北电、南宋、西电、东宋的联网格局，依托中美洲实现北美洲和南美洲的跨洲互联，大洋洲。 建设澳大利亚与印度尼西亚等国的海底直流电网工程，实现澳大利亚与东南亚电网的互联，将丰富的太阳能输送至东南亚的负荷中心。总之，建设全球能源互联网是推动世界能源转型、实现可持续发展的战略方向，发展前景广阔，综合价值巨大，当务之急是。 汇聚全球的智慧和力量，共同行动起来，加快推动全球能源互联网的创新发展。第三个部分，三网融合与经济转型。基于全球能源互联网的研究与实践，我们又提出了三网融合的构想，即推进能源、信息、交通及瓦特、比特。 米特、三网融合发展，能源网嘛就是瓦特网，信息网是比特网，交通网是米特，三网融合发展，为世界经济的转型创造新的机遇，注入新的动力，实现新的发展。什么是三网融合？三网融合是指能源网、信息网、交通网在网络的形态、业务功能、资源利用等方面。 形成更紧密的联系，实现通道共享、设施共用、终端共建和功能集成，形成全球的综合性基础设施平台，使全球基础设施互联互通的高级形态，将推动世界经济从传统的工业经济向新型的网络经济、数字经济、共享经济升级，实现。 高度的电气化、高度智能化、高度人本化的发展目标，推进三网融合的基础条件和重点任务。当前，三大网络的技术日趋成熟，具备加快推进的基础条件。依托大容量的广前通信技术，信息网实现了从局域网、广域网。 到全球互联网的升级，目前全球通过250多条大容量的海底光缆、700多颗通信卫星实现了信息互联互通。全球铁路里程超过了130万公里，高速公路里程超过了230万公里，高速铁路技术已经广泛应用，铁路与航空、海运一起形成了全球的综合交通网络。 与信息网、交通网相比，能源网的互联明显滞后。但陶格亚技术的突破，能源配置范围由小到大，配置能力由弱到强，配置效率由低到高。就是过去能源互联网最滞后，主要是受技术的制约，有了陶格亚交流和陶格亚直流这个技术以后，使 发展全球能源互联网成为现实，成为可能啊。 加快建设以特格亚电网为骨干网架的全球能源互联网，将弥补能源网这个短板，为实现“三网融合”发展创造条件。大家看，将来的这个电动汽车，就是能源信息、交通“三网融合”发展的为硕景观。电动汽车，用能源在路上跑，由车联网平台、电动汽车将来就是“三网融合”的最微小的微硕景观。推进“三网融合”的重要意义，推动“三网融合”发展是现代经济社会发展的必然要求。具有巨大综合价值，一是推动全球经济转型，将有力促进绿色能源互联网经济、智能交通等领域创业创新发展，激发新需求，催生新业态，打造全球经济增长的新引擎；二是降低社会的发展成本，有利于实现网络设施和服务的开放共享、高效利用，减少资源消耗，取得巨大的规模效益。二是创造智慧美好生活，以更智能、可持续的方式，让人人享有 可持续的方式，让人人享有清洁、绿色能源和便捷高效的信息与交通服务，将促进智慧城市、智慧国家、智慧地球的建设。四是促进世界共同发展，将有力推动基础设施全球覆盖，缩小地区差异，促进区域协调发展， 成为人类进步的强大动力，世界和平的重要纽带，让世界成为一个能源充足、信息畅通、交通发达、天然地绿、亮亮堂堂、和平和谐的地球村。能源网、信息网、交通网，就像人的血管系统、神经系统和四肢系统，既各自分工又是有机的整体。 能源网啊，就相当于人的血管系统，信息网就相当于人的神经系统，交通网就是人的四肢系统啊。大家看，现在信息互联网已经建成，这就是现实啊，已经建成。当然还在提升。虽然信息通讯互联网全球建成了，也有弊端，比如有黑客。但是谁绝没有说因为有黑客 自己把自己国家解掉，全球能源互联网建起来也可能有荒客，但是最后谁也不会解，利大于弊，遇到什么问题解决什么问题啊。依托现代信息和交通技术、神经系统、四肢系统，已经基本实现全球互联；基于特格亚技术，血管系统也一定能够实现全球互联， 推动世界经济发展步入“三网融合”发展的新的时代。女士们、先生们，发展特格亚电网、建设全球能源互联网、推进“三网融合”，将为世界能源变革、经济发展和人类命运共同体的建设开辟新的道路。全球能源互联网的发展合作组织自成立以来，一直致力于 理念传播、战略研究、国际合作和项目推进。正像主持人介绍的一样，我是去年5月份不再担任中国国家电公司的董事长，现在主要是在全球能源互联网组织和中国电力企业联合会工作。其实没到这边来之前，没成立这个组织之前，他的很多理论研究、很多的研究 早就已经进行了，否则不会在这一年多的时间有这么大的突破、这么多的成果。得到了联合国、世界银行、国际能源署、国际电工委员会等国际组织和有关国家政府、企业、机构的大力支持，我们愿意同瑞典皇家工程院以及有关方面开展务实合作， 为推动能源与经济、社会、环境协调发展做出积极的贡献， 携手共创人类美好的未来。我的发言完了，谢谢大家。
Thank you, Mr. Liu. I think that all of us are taken by this tremendous vision. And before we go into discussing this, we would like to take another aspect. I mentioned that Denmark in the 1990s was pioneering the development of wind power. And we also know that we want to build wind power where the winds are rich, and they are very rich in the North Sea. There is, however, a problem with the North Sea, and that is it has proven to be quite difficult to provide the transmission infrastructure to develop the North Sea wind resources in a profitable way. So now we have innovation on a different level, I would say, and there's conceptual innovation that will be presented by Peter Jørgensen from Energinet Denmark. He will explain an idea, a great idea, how we could reduce the cost for transmission grids and also enabling a large-scale build-out of wind power in the North Sea. So Peter, most welcome to, it's difficult to, of course, to come after this global, but bring it down and make it practical, Jörg, Peter.
Thank you.
Thank you very much for the invitation to come here and share some of our ideas of how to bring down the grid costs and exploit the big potential for wind power in the North Sea. And with the title of mega transmission, I think we're now going to micro mega transmission. First, a few words about Energinet. I'm employed with Energinet. Energinet is part of this feasibility study on the North Sea wind power hub. Energinet is the Danish transmission system operator for electricity and gas, so it's the Danish version of Svenska Kraftnet. We are about 1,000 employees. I think that's a very small company in Chinese context, but Denmark is a very small country. We are a public company owned by the Minister of Climate and Energy, and we are not for profit, so we try to optimize the socio-economic welfare on behalf of Denmark on the solutions we develop. And our mission is very simple. It's to ensure reliable energy for society. And at the same time, the vision is to bring and create balance in a sustainable energy system. And I think that complies very much with the goals of GEI also, but on a little smaller scale. And with balance, we do not only mean the physical balance, but also the economic, the socio-economic, the environmental. It has to be balanced solutions. A little about the Danish case first, before we go to the North Sea. This is the energy balance in Denmark, in the electricity system in 2015. 2015 was a better wind year than 16, that's why I stick to 15. The wind power share was 42%, which is more than the sum of all the generation on the thermal plants, the large power plants and the local power plants, all CHP. And we had a very large share of trade. We are part of a larger area, and Bo already mentioned that we need our neighbors. And I think the neighbors need us too. We have a common market, and the trade and the exchange is on market-based terms. So nobody is buying or selling without making money on this. And 18% net import sounds as a big share. But actually, if you look at the numbers for import and export in the table, the two last lines, you see that this is just the net import, which is the difference between a larger import, very large import, and a large export. So we are very heavy in trade with our neighbors. To demonstrate the challenge we face as a system operator of electricity system today, I've taken this picture from a week, a typical Danish week, where you see the demand in the 7 days, starting from Monday, ending by Sunday. And all of you in the electricity business, you can recognize this pattern. It's typical. And you can also see that Friday afternoon, we become a bit lazy. We start the weekend. So the demand never picks up to the same level Friday afternoon. In the same week, I've shown the hourly values for the wind power feed into our system. And you can see it varies from very low wind input Monday morning, Tuesday, and on Friday, to levels where it meets the total demand in Denmark and even exceeds the demand in Denmark. So this is everyday challenge from our control center. And actually, the way we solve this is by market-based solutions. The wind power participates in the market, the electricity market, as all other generation. And I was happy to hear that you also stressed the markets as very important for the trade, also on a global level. Because the way we solve this is the market price is setting the signals, and actually we can balance this system without curtailing the wind power. And that's a challenge they have in many other countries, that they have to curtail a lot of the wind power. We do not curtail wind power. The last time we curtailed wind power from our central dispatch was New Year's Eve 2009. And you know, we celebrate New Year, everybody is drinking, celebrating, we have candle lights, and then we'll have a full-blown storm, and there's no use for electricity. That's the last time we curtailed. Today, it's all cleared in the market, even in the regulating market, where wind power can sell down regulation. So it's market-based solutions. Well, we are part of a larger market, as I said. And this is just an illustration of the large number of interconnectors we have around our country. And we will have even more in a few years. We are planning a link to UK, from Denmark to UK. And we see the infrastructure as the hardware that we need to balance in a larger geographical area. And then we need to have the market as the software to ensure that electricity always flows from low price to high price in a whole area. And we have the whole of Europe market coupled now. So it should, in principle, it doesn't always work, but in principle, we should always ensure a merit order dispatch, never curtailing wind power with the lowest marginal cost, but always stopping the most expensive generation where you use fossil fuels, and then full utilization of wind power in the whole market coupled area. So you can see the European ambitions on common transmission planning and market coupling is a first step. We are not that ambitious now that we go for the global, but we have the European goals and we are well on the way. Well, Denmark is very ambitious. Europe is ambitious on renewable energy. We will pass 50% wind power by 2020, and that's the day after tomorrow when you talk about electricity systems. And all decisions are made for this. By 2050, Denmark will be independent of fossil fuels. So the development and the results we have achieved so far, it's just a step on the way. And we have to go further and find further solutions. And in Denmark, we have almost no sun, we have no mountains, no hydro, but we had a lot of wind. So it's very natural for us that wind power will be a large share of this solution. Just a quick picture of the capacity, the installed capacity. You can see today we still have a little more capacity on thermal power plants than on solar and wind, but only in a couple of years the wind capacity will exceed the thermal capacity in the system. And for Denmark, which is a small country, it's very hard to put up more onshore wind power. We have neighbors, we have people living all over, and anywhere you have neighbors complaining, so we will go offshore And a large, very large share of this wind power will be offshore and mainly in the North Sea. So that's why we are so interested in the good grid solutions. What are the main challenges with offshore? And now we talk far offshore. It's actually the cost level. It's the cost level on the construction, on the maintenance out there, and the infrastructure, the grid connection, the platforms and the cable to bring the electricity ashore. So for us, it's very important to find new solutions to bring down these costs. If you look at the costs, and they were already mentioned earlier today, on the generation for wind power, we have seen a tremendous fall in cost during the last, actually the last few years, very few years. And we expect that this will continue in the future. And when the vendors of wind power, they can show us these numbers, they look at us as a TSO and then say, okay, we did our part of this, now we are waiting for you. So they want us to bring down the cost also to balance their cost reduction. So we have to look for new solutions. And if we just look at the expected development of cost with the traditional ways of doing it, then this should illustrate the cost split up in the capex, the investment for the plant, the generator, and then for the grid connection, and then operation and maintenance, fixed and variable. And you will see from 2015 to 2030, the expectation is that the generation cost will decrease substantially. But if we continue with the same technology for connecting the wind farms far offshore, where we have to go to DC solutions, the cost will only be have a smaller reduction, and we have to find new ways of doing this. So this is the main trigger for Energinet and our partner TenneT, the German and Dutch TSO, to look into the idea of this North Sea wind power hub. So a possible solution here would be an international cooperation. And I apologize, there's no link to Norway and Sweden in this. In some other maps, there are always also other connections. This is still on the feasibility stage. And I have to say this because otherwise, Energinet might be excused to already start building this. This is just feasibility now. We are pursuing the idea. But it's very easy to conclude from the climate agreements, the commitments there, that to solve this on a European level, we have to realize a rather large potential in the North Sea. And one calculation shows that we will need 150 gigawatt of wind power in the North Sea to realize these goals on reduction of CO2. And again, this is also very much in line with the GEI, that you have to utilize the resources where they are. Don't build the wind farm in the backyard in Germany where there's no wind. We are a European community. We have to utilize the solar where it is and the wind where is it. And this, there we have the potential in the North Sea. This requires international cooperation, and that's one of the challenges to realize this, to find the right business case and the governance model for realizing such a big project. If we look at location, possible locations, we have to look for a good combination of shallow waters where the foundation is not too expensive. We have to look for good wind conditions, and also a central location if we go for an international cooperation. And one possibility here is the so-called Dogger Bank in the North Sea. You can see this is UK, and you have the Netherlands down there. So it's in the middle of the North Sea. And the yellow lines, they illustrate the borders between the countries. So they have the UK area, you have a little bit of the Norwegian, you have the Danish, and then the Dutch, the German, it's becoming very narrow towards the Dogger Bank, and then the Dutch area. So the borders meet in this shallow watered area where we have very good wind resources. So this could be a potential site for realizing this project. The main benefit of such a combined grid solution and interconnector project is actually by combining the traditional way of interconnecting countries with an interconnector that can be used 100% for trade, and then separate connectors for wind power. But since the wind is not blowing 100% all the time, the wind power connection will only be utilized with maybe 40 to 50% of the installed capacity over time. So by combining this, you can actually increase the utilization of this expensive infrastructure. And that's part of the business case for doing this. This is an illustration of how it could look. So instead of putting tons of electrical equipment on tons of steel platforms, which is very expensive. And I learned today that 1 ton of electrical equipment requires 4 ton of platform steel, and that's what makes it so expensive. And actually sometimes is a breaker of the business case for offshore DC. But by building an island out there, the weight doesn't matter anymore. And you can build it as a modular basis. You can connect wind farms on AC because far offshore becomes actually near shore with an island. So you can connect with AC to the island. On the island, you can convert to DC to interconnectors to the different countries, and you can do this modularly. You don't need the DC breaker because you have an AC grid between it, and there is a lot of other advantages also on maintenance and so on. The future work can build on some experience we already gained. We are now constructing together with 50 Hertz in Germany. In Ginet and 50 Hertz is building the Kriegers Flak combined grid solution, where we have Danish wind farms and German wind farms on Kriegers Flak, which is the Baltic version of the Dogger Bank. It's a shallow watered area where actually the Swedish, the Danish, and the German waters meet. We started the project with Energinet, 50 Hertz, and Svenska Kraftnät, but since there were no plans for Swedish offshore wind on this site, Svenska Kraftnät had to withdraw, very regretfully for us, because we could have realized a multi-terminal solution, but we continued with 50 Hertz, and this is now built. And just with this very simple solution, we need some very advanced, for instance, the master controller on how to ensure the flows. We started with offshore DC, but the prices were so high that we ended up with a back-to-back DC connection in Germany. So it's all AC offshore. But with an island, we can overcome this challenge. Another perspective in balancing, we heard that electricity will be the energy system, will be the backbone of the energy system in the future. So balancing issues will be very important, and gas is a very intensive energy carrier, and we can make gas, synthetic gases, from excess electricity. So one option is actually to have electrolysis plants on the island, and then maybe even integrate this with the existing gas, natural gas structure in the North Sea. So that's another potential that can help on the business case for such a project. Today, we have a cooperation between TenneT, which is the TSO in the Netherlands and in Germany, and in Energinet. And we welcome other infrastructure operators in the project. We want more participants from the countries around the North Sea. We have done some studies on the wind capacity. It looks good. Some ecological quick scans and further studies on ecology, fish and bird wildlife. And we have translated the COP commitments to megawatts, necessary megawatts that could help building the business case for this. But we have a lot of studies ongoing and future studies to come to a real business case. And that's why I'm not mentioning any costs, any numbers here, because that's a bit too early to start on this. So we look forward to continue this project and hope that we can end the feasibility study successfully and go into development and then construction. And maybe we will see an island in 2035 and maybe a full solution in before 2050. We hope so. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you very much, Peter. Then I invite all the speakers to take a chair here for a final discussion. And I also invite Magnus Hall, CEO of Vattenfall, to join us in the panel. So I think I will start with, we heard Vattenfall mentioned as a builder of wind power plants. So Magnus, I start with you. I've been listening now about how important is it for you, these plans for building transmission infrastructure? Because you are not building transmission, but you're building power plants. And how important is wind power? Oh, sorry, I haven't got one. Yeah. How important is wind power and for your future strategy?
Well, can you hear me? Yeah,
yep.
That's fine. I'll mix the one with the phone, so hopefully you don't get my calls. Well, I'm very happy to listen into everything you're saying here, because I think that wind power is certainly a solution for the future. And offshore wind power, I think you mentioned quite clearly what we see in Denmark, that onshore wind power is getting increased resistance because of people not wanting to have them. It's not in your backyard type of thing. You like it, but you don't like it behind your house, and perhaps that's understandable. And then the solution to bring it out to sea is something that we can see clearly is developing, and where we are putting a lot of efforts into. From the Vattenfall perspective, we believe that big time generation and the costs are coming down. I think I saw your quite ambitious 2030 figure there. Let's hope we go down all the way to that, because that means that we are at competitive levels. I mean, we have a big discussion today about zero bids for offshore wind, which is sort of a breaking ground, like just mentioned by Thomas Kohlberger. But from our perspective, where this is music to our ears in that respect. But of course, that business and that wind power business in all aspects, the developers, the producers of various types of equipment, that has to really now focus. I think there will be some sort of a shakeout around the corner, but after that, this will continue to grow and be a big business. So, of course, from our perspective, very positive.
I think I have a question for Mr. Liu here, because all these plans are spectacular. I think technology-wise, there have been big progress made, but what about the political issues? Because, I mean, we struggle to get along in Europe between the countries, and now we go and take it to the next level. So what are the, how do you see the political implication? How possible will it be?
这个要谈政治，首先讲是不是符合他的利益啊？就是发展清洁能源、构建全球能源互联网，它符合全人类的利益，也符合每一个国家的国家利益。这个国家是哪个执政党在执政，哪个党在执政，他为了要老百姓这个选票。 所以说，也符合他的利益，啊，我想这是所谓，啊，利益关系，啊，其实最后也是个政治，在一点呢，大家知道，由于华氏能源的生产到使用，带来环境污染、气候变化，啊，温度上升、气候变化，啊，这已经危机了人类的安全和可持续发展。其实这个问题就是最大的政治，啊，人的生存最大政治，啊，特别是巴黎协定的签署，实际也是一个国家之间的政治上的一个同意，啊，但具体的来讲，在构建全球能源互联网过程当中，比如说要建清洁能源基地、太阳能风电基地，要建输电线路，必然要和老百姓打交道，会有一些困难，会有一些工作量，这也是必然的，啊，我想无论从道理和时间角度看，啊，将来在技术、经济、政治上一定会是同一起来的。
Thomas, I mean, we know you since many years. You have been following the development of renewable energy. And recently, I think all of us have been surprised, taken by surprise again. So what is the surprise we haven't seen yet, Thomas?
Well, I think that what is surprising is not the direction of the development, because I think many of us have been able to foresee that these cost trends would continue. What is most difficult to predict is the speed, mm-hmm. and when it starts and when what happens. So I think we can still predict that we will get more of these international transmission lines, and we will get a substitution of fossil fuels in not for electricity production but in other sectors by renewable electricity. And what is interesting is the competitions that we have discussed today. That transmission lines is one solution, batteries is another solution, producing electrofuels is another solution to make valuable the renewable electricity that sometimes occurs in greater amounts than you want at that particular place. And this development, this competition between different solutions is extremely constructive, mm-hmm. because it challenges engineers of these different technologies to develop the system so that costs fall. And I think this constructive competition will make us solve the fossil fuel or climate change problem much faster than most people believe. I think the IEA is pessimistic.
We have, as I said in Sweden, we have no representative from IEA here, but I'm sure they would agree. Let's open. If we have this has been a fascinating story told here. If we can take some from the audience as well. There are microphones between the chairs, and we have, of course, Björn gets the first question.
Yes, that's my privilege. No, sorry. No, should we, if we start to build intercontinental like 10 gigawatt power lines, we know we can have very low losses. Should we be concerned by terrorism, and how do we solve that?
Oh, Who takes that? Should we be concerned? Thomas,
relates to the previous question on the security when getting dependent. I mean, we have benefit of countries cooperating, exchanging electricity back and forth. And then we have the other kind of dependence when one country is importing and the other is exporting. A terrorist who just want to destroy for everyone can, of course, destroy that. They could also attack food transport systems and other things that we are very dependent on. But sometimes I think we are exaggerating these problems. If we look at the current conflict areas in Europe, the Ukraine. People are fighting and killing and shelling each other, but the gas transmission line is untouched because both sides depend on it. One, because they need the energy, and the other, because they need the money. But of course, there is a vulnerability, but everything is vulnerable. And here the benefits, as Liu points out, the benefits are large. We should see these benefits and use them.
Over the, I think on the top there, is it Magnus?
Yes, it's Magnus. Magnus Olofsson, Nordic Energy Research. Renewables are developing very fast. We see a strong cost reduction. But do we see a sufficiently fast cost reduction and development in transmission technology?
I think that has to go to Peter. I mean, you're in the business of buying this stuff.
Yeah. Actually, we were surprised with the cost level for the solutions on the Kriegers Flak, and the prices we thought we had heard about could make a good business case. But when we got the indicative prices from the vendors, we were very surprised. They were about 50% higher than expected, and that was the basis. It simply destroyed the business case, and we had to put the DC onshore instead of offshore. So I do not see, I'm not a specialist, I know there are other experts here, I'm not a specialist in this technology, but I see that we have, as TSO, to find and develop new solutions with the existing technology to make it more efficient. And that's where we try to put it onshore instead, and then go with the AC solutions, because they are much simpler, they are much cheaper, and then we can build the island or whatever to bring offshore, far offshore, close to shore, and then have a combination of AC and DC. But I think somebody else should give the long perspective on the cost of DC solutions here. I'm not an expert on this.
Maybe we ask Mr. Liu, because I guess you in 1 week buy more than Denmark buys in a year or two. So please, what is your assessment on cost development for transmission?
关于成本这个问题，是非常重要的，也是人们长期关注的还要解决的问题。为什么要发展特高压？就是为了增强竞争性，来降低成本，提高了电压，与输送功率和提高电压的平方成正比。特别提高电压以后，输送同样的功率，电流要大大的减小。 电流减小了以后，就会使这个线路的损耗来减小。再一个呢，电压的提高使输送的功率增大，就使单位投资成本带来的输送能力的增大，等等，这些都是降低成本的做法。
So, Peter, you are building too small, that's the answer.
Yes, we are too small. We have to pay for that. But we rely on our neighbors.
Please, question that. Yeah.
I'm Wei Li from KDH, Royal Institute of Technology. I have a question to Mr. Liu. In your perspective, what is the main challenge for the operations in control center when we're trying to reach the global energy network? 当我们想去实现这个全球能源的互联网的时候，对于控制中心来说，什么是最大的挑战呢？谢谢。
就现实来看， 全球各个国家都会有一个或者几个 控制中心，同理可证，将来全球能源互联网也应该有控制中心，比如有全球的控制中心，有区域性的，比如每个州的控制中心，或者州下边的几个国家在设，啊，分层分级设控制中心，这都是可行的、合理的。我认为这个控制中心啊，从我的看法，没有太大的问题。 在现有的 控制中心当中的一些技术已经在实行和试点，将来的控制中心假如需要新的技术，可以再进行新的研发。从我现在看，没有过不去的技术问题。
Thanks a lot for a very interesting speech. We heard Mr. Liu tell us that it's not primarily a technical problem or a problem of money, that it's rather a market problem. And I think that's very interesting because all these resources are ready to deliver to the energy market for a net margin price very close to zero. And you also said, Mr. Liu, that you are conducting a lot of research on how such a market should work. So I would like to ask you, what do you think would be a decent market design for a market with only renewables? And I would also like Magnus from Vattenfall, as a utility, to comment on that answer, if it's possible to demand so much.
Mr. Luford.
这个刚才我在发言的时候讲到，世界的清洁能源这个量足够的大，清洁能源有个品质问题，有个开发成本问题，也有个需求问题，所以将来清洁能源的开发，以后必然要找到合适的市场，啊，这个市场一它有需求量。 第二，价格要有竞争力。如果没有需求量，谈不上价格；如果有需求量，价格你太高，没有竞争力，他也不会去要。啊，首先有竞争力。啊，我想这个电力应该怎么呢？假如从北非输送到欧洲，欧洲当地会有他的供电商，他买了以后他再去配给，而不是一杆子插到底，就是一个供电。 售电商不是的，是各个层级都有的，像批发和零售的关系一样，要这样去做，钱不要都自己一家来挣，要大家都来挣，积极性才高。Yeah,
I was asked to comment. I think this is one of the big problems that we have when we look at the next phase of the world development for or. Whatever market development you have when renewables with a marginal price of zero is coming into the picture, of course. And you will have to find other ways of remunerating the operators. That's obvious. And if you're going to take an investment decision where you know that practically you can sell a lot of your electricity at zero, you have to have some sort of fixed component in the system. And exactly how that will work and how that will look, I think, is very difficult. I think it will take several years. I mean, we talk about 10, 15 years before it becomes real reality, because in the meantime, we do have a lot of fossil-based price setting in the system. But somewhere you see the turning point, and of course, that's the issue for a serious talk about a zero bid for a big wind farm costing 10 billion Swedish crowns. Of course, you have to calculate what prices are you expecting beyond 2030. Becomes difficult. But you can also think that, are we going to stop building new electricity generation when we know it's a solution to the climate issue? There is a lot of costs are going to come down. We don't believe that there will be a stop. It's just a question for how are we going to create the system? And there is no sort of very obvious solution to that. But it has to be different, very different than today. That's quite clear.
Thomas?
I think it's important to distinguish between market design in the sense the legislation setting the conditions for trading on the electricity grid. I don't think there is any need for change in the current rules. The balance responsibility issue is the key component. But then if you talk about business models that will make it possible to make a fair decent living for a company in an electricity market with a lot of renewables, then you need to be much more clever than we have been. And the concept of a smart grid, which is also a term I don't like because I don't think the grid will be smart, but smart consumers and producers well-informed using information technology can achieve a lot. And one of the important things that will come as a result of more renewables and sometimes very low electricity costs and prices is that we will have a more flexible demand structure. I would, for example, imagine that when electricity-intensive industry see the opportunity of very low-priced electricity during some periods, while very high electricity prices at others, some of the process industries that have designed all their processes to minimize capital cost and buy stable, cheap electricity will find ways of utilizing periods of low electricity prices and avoid producing when electricity prices are high and by those processes become more competitive. That's the kind of solution that will also make the price formation more efficient and avoid zero or even the ridiculous negative electricity price. Is there any engineer here who cannot find an entertaining way to use electricity when the price is negative? I mean, it's so much opportunity, but we haven't got that opportunity as consumers.
Certainly, this was a question that could require a special seminar. You could hear that. It's fascinating. We talk about the problem with low prices. Well, for Magnus, I can understand. For the rest of us,
we can live with it, but we just want to have our returns on investment.
Maybe one more question, please.
Thank you. Thank you for a very interesting seminar. I came here from Chalmers University of Technology, and I'm not an engineer, so I deal with the social aspects, let's say, of the future of our electricity systems. So, as we all know, we're kind of aiming towards 100% renewable energy system in the future, but there's different scenarios of how this can be accomplished. One of them is a more distributed system where you have proposals for peer-to-peer trading and systems where the users would become prosumers and have a large role. I wonder, how do you feel about these different proposals? Is the global energy interconnection conflicting with these other more distributed scenarios, or is it more complementary? Thank you.
I think, Thomas, you touched upon this already, but Mr. Liu, for instance, how do you see this complementary or competing solutions for energy?
首先讲这个清洁能源，无论集中式、分布式，都应该得到重视，而不应该顾此失彼。首先要把这个态度讲明白。有了全球能源互联网，有这么一个大的平台，才能够有利于清洁能源，无论是集中式还是分布式这种开发模式，才有利于。 你比如讲吧，分布式，假如说都是使得格尔摩，大家都有风电，会对太阳能，同样的气候条件，要么你发会不发，会多发，大家都一样的时候，你发的电供给谁？除了你自己用，别人家也在发电，怎么办？就是要有全球能源互联网这种电力高速公路，把你分布式的每家每户的这种清洁能源集中起来。 传输到另外的国家、另外的大洲去，就是这个道理。所以说，全球能源互联网，它有利于集中式清洁能源发展，也有利于分布式清洁能源的发展。它没有顾此失彼，没有排斥性。啊。I think
that was a good question to end the seminar, because again, we could have another seminar on this, I wouldn't say competing, but complementary solutions. So by that, I would like to thank all the speakers and thank you all for coming and invite you for a mingling hour upstairs here. But before we do that, I would like to especially thank all the speakers. Magnus, you have a small token here. What is it? Yeah. There is coming. Because as a small gift to the speakers, I would like to, I haven't planned this exactly, but it's actually a small battery I will give to them. So, Mr. Liu first.
Thanks, Gerald.
Oops. Interconnect, yes. Magnus,
你送给我礼物，那么我也会赠你礼物。那就是把根据我的学习和实践，先后写的两本书，一个是《超高压角质流电网》，一个是《全球能源互联网》。这个书除了中文，也翻译成了英文和俄文。我在这把这书送给我们共同院，做一个纪念。
I cannot take free gifts from the IVA, therefore I'd like to pass on my knowledge to the IVA. This is two books written by Mr. Liu, the Global Energy Intercollection, and the Ultra High Voltage AC and DC Power Grids, and they are both published in English and Russia. Therefore, I'd like to present these books to Mr. Bonham.
Oh, thank you. So once again, welcome upstairs.